in darkness, life and death, good and evil, creation and destruction. This type of duality is the backbone of most modern stories, especially in a medium like video games, where you need to give a goal to the player. Killing the bad guy and helping the light side triumph is one of the most common ways this system of opposites is implemented, but it contradicts itself by encouraging you to destroy everything the dark side has created. It sends you to a place and whispers in your ears wishes of complete annihilation. So, why not inspire the players to create instead, revive and resurrect, rather than kill and decimate? Terranigma is an action role-playing game developed by Quintet and published by Enix for the Super Nintendo Entertainment System. It hit the Japanese market in October of 1995 and subsequently was released in Europe 1 year later in 1996. Sadly, it was never released in the Americas though. It is grouped by fans with two other games from the same developer to form the Quintet or Heaven and Earth trilogy. Different from similar games of the same era, the focus from the developers was giving the players perspective on the consequences of their actions by, instead of sending them to destroy a stronghold, setting them on a mission to resurrect the planet and all organisms that conform it. With a solid control scheme, gorgeous art direction, and a compelling and interesting story, the game became one of the pillars for what a good RPG should be, except for the part where it was never released for the Americas, like Dune. What? So, after hearing about it for the first time thanks to you guys, I decided to play it myself and hopefully find what made this such a special experience for most people that played it almost 30 years ago. Bring your plants, get some water and lots of fertilizer, because we are saving the planet, boys!
Thank you.
We are Ark, or whatever name you decide to give the main character. A young troublemaker living in the town of Krista. We wake up in the elder's house and find our childhood friend Ellie right next to our bed, asking if we are okay. Apparently, we've been having nightmares. Ooh, so ominous. She recommends we go to get some fresh air and check the crystal blue, a natural phenomenon consisting of blue bubbles appearing in the sky. We follow her advice, and that's when we gain control of the main character for the first time. After learning that we can save in these little books, we proceed to interact with everyone in town, from the fortune teller to the fucking
pumpkin,
until we only have the Weaver's place left. Apparently, before the start of the game, we did a bit of trolling with some chickens and ruined some of their work, which means we need to apologize for our misdeeds. After uploading our apology video, we go back to the elders, where a group of villagers are trying to open a blue door sealed by the elder himself. Why are they doing that? Elementary, my dear PogChamp. Someone has been screaming for help from behind the door for almost a week, which I guess is something normal in this town, given how no one thought it was strange or even had the thought that maybe the elder is a fucking kidnapper or a serial killer. Like, dude, I know it's the Middle Ages, but come on, you can't be this dense. Anyway, as the completely rational and definitely not mentally stunted individuals we are, we get peer pressure into smashing the shit out of that door with some vases. Seeing how everyone else chickens out on the thought of going in, we take the initiative and descend into the darkness. Reaching the deepest part of the basement, we find the source of the screams. A box, from which, after approaching it, emerges the second chillest dude in the entire game, our boy Yoni. He explains that the elder trapped him in the box to keep the people of the town from using it, and then proceeds to show us the inside of this cubic artifact, giving us a tutorial on what is essentially our inventory and pause menu, a detail that, if I'm being honest, is in my opinion an ingenious way of integrating menus into a game while expanding the lore and stuff, like, makes it more organic. After getting and equipping our first weapon, we pull out and find Ellie, so surprised with our new 15-inch spear that she gets frozen in place along with the rest of the town. We panic for a little bit, then talk to the elder, which suspiciously is the only one who's not frozen, and after some exposition, we get our first quest, beating 5 towers, which will unfreeze the peeps of the town. We make our way to the first tower through the most crazy and gorgeous looking scenario in any game I've seen, and after having a small conversation with the door, we go in. Here's the first time we enter combat, and let me tell you, I love this combat system. It's extremely simple, but the controls are so responsive and the moves so nice that you don't need to add anything else to it. Literally the definition of less is more. You have one attack linked to each movement option. If you run and attack, you get a dash. If you stay still and spam attack, you get a combo attack. If you jump, you get an aerial attack. If you add a bit of speed to that jump, you get a dive variant. And if you're crawling out of a hole, you get a low attack. They literally give you a tool for every scenario by only combining the two main mechanics of any game, which is so cool. After beating the first tower and rescuing the souls trapped in it, we get a cutscene showing the resurrection of a continent. Now we know what these towers are really for. We defeat the remaining 4 and go back to converse with our boy the elder. Even though we rescue the town's peeps, he starts rambling about the resurrection of the continents, how humans have been wiped from the earth along with animals and plants, and encourages to jump into a hole that will take us to the surface of the planet with the intention of resurrecting the rest of the organisms. We, as the independent and free-thinking beings we are, say fuck it, why not, and jump into the abyss. Lights on. We regain consciousness. We are surrounded by an inhospitable and barren landscape. This is Earth. Exploring the surrounding area, we stumble upon a big and decrepit tree from which an unknown voice asks us for help. We later found out the voice comes from the rat tree. The insides of the tree are overrun with plants-based monsters, all thriving in the carcass of this once great tree, now relegated to the feeding ground for a massive parasite. Naturally, we have an epic fight with the parasite, and after defeating it, a beautiful cutscene shows the green coming back to this sad and dead world. Outside, we find the now healthy tree thanking us for saving his kind and gifting us the grass pin. And now is the perfect time to explain what these are. Magic, in this game, is tied to three things: pins, rings, and magic rocks. Magic rocks are the base component of the system, a mineral filled with the magic power of the world. Useless by itself, but it allows you to craft the other two. Rings are crafted from magic rocks and have different elements, each element counting with a weak and a strong spell essentially. Then the last component are pins, powerful spells only acquired after going past a certain story beat that can also be crafted with magic rock. To be honest, I can't give you much feedback on this system in particular because I didn't use it that much. Why? Well, because I didn't realize that you could set up a quick way of casting them, and this is in part thanks to me being stupid and in part thanks to the game not explaining this system that well. So, rings and pins are stored in a different menu from items, armor, and weapons, and this menu is represented by a jewelry box located in the same room as the system and stats menus of your character. But in the item menu, you have 5 separate slots for key items, of which, from the beginning of the game, the first is already being occupied by the jewelry box. Because the game didn't say anything, I assumed the only way you could access and use the rings and pins was by going to this jewelry box and selecting the specific one you wanted to use, which meant pausing the game, going through the menu, selecting the thing. Overall, not a practical way of using the system. But later on, I discovered that no, you can actually choose to equip the jewelry box found in the item menu and, when activated, choose the specific spell you wanted to cast without having to pause the game. And yeah, in hindsight, it's a good way to implement the system without slowing down the gameplay. But I didn't know that for like 80% of the game, so by the time I had figured out the shortcut, it was pretty much irrelevant for me. So, where were we? Oh yeah, trees, parasites, and pins. We say goodbye to Ra, and after gathering some information with the other plants, we get tipped off about the birds and how they also disappeared. We make our way to the place they were last seen at, Greencliff. Inside, surprise surprise, we find bird-looking monsters. We defeat the dark twins and resurrect the drone, the bird population. Talking to their fat-ass king reveals that the wind has also disappeared, But luckily, this time we don't have to beat another dungeon. Instead, we just take a girl to the Wind Vale and wake the most reliable depiction of the wind up. Okay, plants, check. Birds, check. Wind, check. Breasts. I do believe we are missing some breasts. To Safarium, then. We take one of our boys, the gulls, to Africa and find the paradise of mammals. Empty. Which can only mean one thing. Time to do another dungeon. This time, filled with reptiles and amphibians, because I guess they are the evil version of mammals? Like a frog is the evil version of a chihuahua, maybe? I don't know. This time to reach the boss, we activate 4 rain altars located throughout the dungeon, then go medieval on the ass of a summoner and an ancient god. We get another cute cutscene showing the mammals being resurrected, and then help a baby lion on a test to become an actor in the Lion King remake or something like that. I'm not sure I stopped paying attention on that part. After that whole ordeal, we converse with Orgies and discuss how there are still no traces of the boldest mammals of them all. That's right, the naked mole rat. And his cousin, the big bases, and the rest of humanity as a whole. So, we go directly to Tibet, where they lie dormant. We climb some mountains, kill some monsters, get buried beneath the snow by an avalanche, meet a goat who immediately starts to go full society of the snow in his recently deceased husband's ass, climb back up the mountain, chill with the jetties for a little bit, and finally go against the big baddie of this dungeon. A vampire kind of dude, or at least I assume it was a vampire, mainly because he transformed into a bunch of bats, and I guess he didn't like garlic. Sure. The dawn of a new day is upon us. We wake up after having a psychedelic dream about chickens and dudes. Chicken dudes, if you will. An old-timer explains that we basically fell into a coma after resurrecting the humans and we've been sleeping for years now. Since then, civilization has flourished around the world. We are in the village of Lhasa, led by a wise monk called Kumari. We get an audience with him to fill in the blanks on what is going on, and hopefully get a clue on what the hell we should do next. A exposition section begins with him telling us how important we are, how we are destined for special things, yada yada, and also reveals that we no longer can talk to plants or animals because I guess the developers really did not want to have a Doolittle situation going on with the rest of the humans. Oh, and we need to rescue a random girl because her grandpa asked us to, and I mean, we got nothing to do at the moment, so why not? The girl is located in one of the coolest locations of the entire game. A city lost in the desert, protected by an illusion fabricated in the mind of the brat we're supposed to be looking for. When we enter, the city looks like any other city. We explore for a bit, and after locating Maylene's house, that's the kid, we meet her parents and confront her, only to then get yelled at and basically thrown out of the house, which, like my boy Mikaeli would say,
hell no.
But wait, now that I mention it, I thought the girl's parents were killed by monsters. Actually, the old man mentioned that the whole city had been destroyed by monsters. Wait, what the heck? Oh, the plot thickens. We find an inn to rest at, and here we meet a traveler excited to finally be able to document the lost city. We go back to our room and let ourselves be carried away by Morpheus's embrace. A scream echoes through the wall. We wake up, disoriented and not knowing what's going on. We find ourselves now in an unfamiliar place, similar to the warm environment of the inn, but abandoned and with a haunting undertone. Deciding to explore we find living, moving corpses populating the halls and subsequently the streets of this new macabre place. Going back to our mission, rescuing Maylin, we explore the city, fight off the monsters on the street, and at some point find Maylin's dog, which guides us to her following the scent left in a scarf. And after reasoning with her and having an otherworldly intervention by her parents, he leaves and we get an apology from the Grandpa Mayhew for the bitch behavior his granddaughter is showing at alarming rates. He explains that the city was being protected by an illusion formed by Maylin's powers, and that by confronting her, we destroyed that illusion. We are told to visit Europe, and after going through a desert and meeting some nomads, we arrive in the city of Lure. Here, an interesting mechanic comes into play. By exploring the town, you get to know inventors and artisans stuck in places that block their creativity and stagnate their progress. By helping these people, and the town in general, you can upgrade the city to a point where you can also get benefits from it, like the ability to buy property and the like, later on once the city is maxed out. And this is a mechanic not exclusive to this city, but available to most cities on the map. Unfortunately for the region, right now the current king and his policies are limiting the growth of the city. Fortunately for us, the same king is currently offering his daughter's hand in marriage to whoever manages to make her talk, which, okay buddy, if I was your daughter being auctioned off to a stranger would definitely make me want to talk and in no way would ruin my mood even more. But anyhow, we visit the castle to try our luck at making this babe talk, when, oh, hold on, the princess is our friend Ellie from Krista, or, well, she's identical, only with brown hair instead of pink. Ignoring that fact, the king is also weirdly insistent on making her talk, but not in like a, oh, my poor daughter kind of way, but in more of a, oh, I need that bitch to talk kind of way. You know what I mean? We explore the castle a little bit to see if maybe there's some useful information to be gathered by talking to the workers or reading in the library. We quickly start painting the picture of a campaign against a small village. Unremarkable, if not for the fact that it is hidden by a magical forest filled with big-ass wolves. The campaign was a success for the attackers, but a complete massacre for the villagers, letting us take a glimpse at the true personality of the king. The reason for the aggression? Like in any good authoritarian state, treason. What type of treason, or the exact motive, is left vague in the books and the tidbits of information we managed to get out of the librarian and the guards, but I imagine we will learn more about this in due time. We comprehend the context a bit more, and by overhearing some of the maids talking, our suspicions are confirmed. The king is using the princess somehow, and is obviously not going to give his crown to the groom, and instead is probably going to murder his ass in either some elaborate Song of Ice and Fire type of scheme, or with the use of good old normal violence. Okay, interesting plot for a game that had us babysit Simba through a day at the canyon. I'm invested now. Good evening, Agent J. The mission we have for you today consists of infiltrating Storkholm Village. How are you supposed to do that? Well, we are not entirely sure, but we do know of the existence of a magical forest that can only be traversed with a special bell-shaped artifact. For the big wolves, we managed to find excerpts of a local legend naming a type of ceremonial whistle as the key to taming them. Good luck, Agent. This message will self-destruct in To get the bell, we use our near-infinite intellect, as well as a bit of luck, and put sleeping medicine in the castle's food to knock out all the castle's inhabitants. Really? Who wrote this? Me. Huh. And is that what actually happens? Huh. Well, that's convenient. Once everyone is asleep, except for Ellie, because she's on that keto grind, you know what I mean? We make our way to the king's chambers, and behind a gold statue, find the sound-producing thing. We still have no idea where that whistle is, but one thing at a time. We venture ourselves into this so-called cursed forest. At the entrance, Lloyd, one of the guys interested in marrying the princess, warns us of the dangers up ahead. We move forward and quickly find out that every enemy basically one-shots us. So we start running like a bitch, avoiding every type of enemy whilst using the veil to find the correct path. At the middle of the breathtaking adventure, a dark silhouette that has been shadowing our movements for some time reveals itself to be... Maylin. She says some important things as always, and we decide to take her with us because, I don't know, her powers may be useful later on, I guess. At the end of the path, a bridge signals the entrance to the village. We cross said bridge and enter a desolate and sad version of our own village, Krista. Confused, a pack of wolves surrounds us, and here is where I would use the whistle if I had one. But unfortunately, my dehydrated, rock-hard, stupid ass forgot that I was supposed to find it. So, time to die over and over without understanding what I'm supposed to do until I get annoyed, look up a guide, read that I need the whistle, realize that I'll have to go back into the forest, scream for a little bit, have a full-on technical existential crisis with the fucking emulator, and then finally go back to get that stupid whistle while running away from big scary wolves. Fast forward and we're back on the castle. The set is ready and we are awaiting our grand entrance. We approach the beautiful princess, look at her, and after a brief intervention from the king, boom! We get transported back to the village where her dead parents take both her hands. Scared, the king starts spilling the beans about how he killed everyone in that village to get a sacred artifact that they swore to protect. And the only survivor was Ellie. How he was planning on using her? The whole shebang. The illusion stops and, startled, the king calls off the audience and we get thrown out the castle. No wifey in sight. Oh, I almost forgot. There's also this B-plot about a Robin Hood-esque figure called White Wind. He wasn't present in the castle's dungeon since the beginning, but I honestly forgot to bring him and then kind of moved on, so yeah, I have no idea where that plot ends. Sorry. We go back to lore where we can exert our God-given right to choose democratically the person who we think will fuck us over the least. Only to then find out that they prefer financing an international war instead of enacting socially responsible policies that benefit the citizens of the country. We go back to Sleep, and the village's elders tells us in our dreams to go west. We depart to the town of Lists, which is coincidentally to the west, trying to find more clues as to where we need to go. When we find our boy Royd, he updates us on the status of lore. Apparently, the king is dead and the princess has disappeared. We explore the place for a bit and after getting bored, we visit some nomads, massage a random girl for money, and then venture into a haunted castle because at least it gives us something to kill the time, I guess. We make our way through enemies and puzzles only to fight at the end a monster version of Bloody Mary, which mops the floor with our asses and helps us realize that we are only level 17. And the guide says the minimum level recommended for this dungeon is 25. We grind the same two enemies for about an hour and then go back to get that bloody booty. After the fight, we stumble upon Christopher Columbus, who's been imprisoned here for a while, thanks to having some beef with the queen of the castle. The one that turned into Bloody Mary and just died, like, a moment ago. By releasing him, the secret art of navigation gets shared with the sailors of Litz and allow us to visit the new continent. Preparing ourselves for the trip, our baby Fida breaks into our rooms and begs us to take Princess Ellie to the new world with us. Because we have no willpower when it comes to the thick warrior mummies, we say yes and the next day get reunited with the princess, which, yes, still has a bitch of an attitude. In the voyage, we kill some ghosts, sleep a little bit, and finally arrive at the port of freedom. Okay, this is getting a bit long, so I'm going to pick up the pace. In the new continent, we meet a bunch of inventors and help them. Watch Alexander Graham Bell get cocked by a guy that can only say one word. The princess disappears. Oh no! We discover another town called Nerd Lake, where the inventor of the airplane has gone missing. We meet the chillest, coolest fucking dude in the entire dude ecosystem. Travel to Brazil for a bit to get molested by Maylin, and then turn her dumb, spoiled, ungrateful, and immature ass down. Save the mermaids from some white fish. I don't know. They're not evil, they're just white. And get our own ship. Tell a boy that his fiance is dead and now swims with the mermaids, and then witness him saying basically that he's going to lick himself to be with her. Enter a cave in a huge lake filled with monsters, save Wilbur Bright with the help of the god of the lake, travel to
China. You go over to China
to get parts to build a plane, defeat an evil Korean dude that coincidentally kidnapped the princess a few days ago. We find her literally out of pure luck because I had already forgotten about her. Find out Prince Ellie's stepdad and this Asian guy work for a so-called Beruga, which I presume is the big baddie. Get our own plane, give the Australians the plans for an airway, travel to Russia where a cult worships the frozen body of Beruga, an evil Russian Elon Musk. Only difference is that this guy is actually, you know, competent and smart. Oh, and also he doesn't get ridiculed almost daily by everyone in the planet. Maybe that was not a good comparison. Anyway, we unfreeze him and get immediately betrayed. Die, get brought back by the power of the people we met, I guess, and then collect some powerful jewels called Star Stones to resurrect the hero. Lights on. We are a baby? Okay, we are in our room. Only this time, Princess Ellie is with us. She mentions how we were abandoned on a path until she found us. She leaves for a moment when pink-haired Ellie comes into the room, being pressed by an unknown voice to finish us now that we are defenseless. She takes us outside and when ordered to kill us, gets interrupted by the princess. We get an anime moment where our boy the monk and the animals and plants we helped along the way give us some words of encouragement, causing us to digivolve into our normal grown-ass selves. The entity behind the voice manipulating Ellie reveals itself to be our boy Yomi? Allied from the beginning with the real BBEG, the village's elder. Also known as Dark Gaia. Apparently, we are an anomaly. There's a light and dark version of everything, from the planet to the organisms inhabiting it, and their existence is cyclical, akin to a clock with 12 hours. But we are the outlier. Since we got conceived, and especially now that we joined our light and dark versions, the world has been in this unnatural 13 hour. And because we are outside the system, we are the only ones who can change it. We get immobilized by Yumi, and while he gets ready to 360 no-scope our ass, Pink Ellie sacrifices herself doing something. I'm not really sure what, but at the end, she and Yumi disappear in a flash of light. After this, we proceed to also turn down the princess. This is optional. If you're a normie, you can choose to romance the princess, I guess. And go back to Baruga's tower to beat his ass. Once there, we get reunited with the whole crew and proceed to mess shit up until we finally find ourselves face to face with Baruga. In an intense moment of sweet irony, he gets sucked into one of the propellers of his ship while trying to escape and fucking dies. Edna was right all along, you guys. Finally, with the main goon gone, now the only logical step to take is killing the main baddie. We go to Krista one last time and confront Dark Gaia. The fight is intense. We need to use every skill we acquired up to this point, and after using almost every consumable, we plunge forward and pierce the body of this enormous monstrosity, putting an end to his life, at least for now, and closing the cycle of life and death momentarily. Fade to black. Lights on. We get teleported to Krista. A voice in our mind thanks us. This voice is Light Gaia. She explains what will happen now. Given that we were an anomaly created by Dark Gaia, and given that he is now dead, we will cease to exist along with all the peeps from Krista. What we are seeing right now is our last day, made possible by the power of Light Gaia stabilizing the dying underworld. With nothing else to say, we are left to enjoy with our friends the last moments of our life, while knowing that the Earth and humanity will thrive and evolve thanks to our help. End scene. That's Terranigma. A pretty good game in my opinion. Love the gameplay and the movement, and although the plot was kind of inconsistent in terms of quality right around the third chapter and a bit slow in the second one, the last chapter becoming a complex idea of duality and how polarization can only be destroyed by understanding the complexity of the human condition and how it contains a part of every single side, made it worth playing through the rest. That and getting to see the skater boy fuck up some robots while doing some sick tricks. Yeah, that it was fucking worth it. But yeah, if you're into action RPGs with interesting stories and satisfying controls, I definitely recommend you playing this game. Thank you so much for watching. I hope the video was to your liking. If you got any game suggestions, you can leave them in the comment section below. Sorry for taking so long with this video, but first of all, the script kept getting longer and longer, so I had to stop myself. Otherwise, I would have ended up with a shittier version of Hamlet. And I also ran into some health issues along the way, so yeah. But the next video probably won't take as long, I promise. Okay, maybe not promise, but it's gonna take some time. What else? I stream on Twitch and here almost every day, so if you like what you saw, you can follow me there, and I would also appreciate it if you, you know, throw a small subscribe into the hat, you know, come on. But anyway, love you guys and see you later. Bye-bye.